to Get to Know Your Bass Player. This is the second installment with Steve Adams, bass player for ALO. Steve, thanks for coming back, man. Let's talk music. Record shop, new album, gigs coming up. I saw that you went on a road trip down the California coast. Tell us about it, man.
Yeah, it was a killer little like vacation kind of work trip. A little bit inspired by, have you seen the Record Safari movie?
No.
Check that out.
Well, yeah.
It's pretty sweet. It's a dude, I think he kind of got hired by Coachella. There's some connection to Coachella. Mm-hmm. Coachella, I guess, has like a little record store on site at their festival.
Oh, cool.
And so he kind of got hired, I think, to like go out, and he's obviously like a professional, like longtime record collector. There's like shots of him in his apartment, like how he stores his records, and so he goes on a trip around the country, and with a budget to buy records and bring them back for the Coachella store. And so he's like meeting all these like record shop owners, and he's like in his car driving. It's like deep thoughts with him.
Yeah.
It's a sweet movie, like really inspiring movie and fun. And so I kind of was like, me and my buddy Dave, we've always talked about doing things like that as well. And we did like a little like one-off like day up to Sacramento as like a little sort of like trip inspired by that kind of stuff. And it was super fun. And I was like, I want to do the coast. I want to go down the coast and find thrift stores and record stores and just like every day have the focus be on like looking for records and seeing what's out there and like meeting record shop owners and seeing how they organize their store and like even like checking out like pricing and seeing how shops price. And and my goal was to like do the coast, like Oakland south, and then I really wanted to go back to Tijuana. I'd been there a few years ago, and I found a couple of record stores there, and I was like, I want to spend two nights in Tijuana and just sort of like check that out again, find those shops, see if I can find some more, get some good tacos.
Yeah,
interesting. I mean, and Tijuana is like kind of too, like, it's funny, I tell people, or I was telling people, and almost everybody's reaction was, oh, I haven't been there in like so many years. And like, I feel like right now is a good time to go. It's like, there's like killer food. There's like craft beers. There's food parks. There's record stores. There's like, it seems like there's a creative, like young culture happening there.
Sweet.
Yeah. So that was the goal. So I got down there and then I came back and I did a little more shopping on the way back. But yeah, I rounded up about two boxes worth of records, which doesn't seem like much, but it actually was like all pretty like handpicked and, you know, thoughtful choices. And now it's like, I have to figure out what I want to keep and what I want to sell at the shop.
That's gotta be tough. Yeah. I was going to ask how that works for you.
I got stuff like that. If I found a good deal on something that I already had, I'm like, oh, I'll get that. Cause I know that's a great record and I want to represent that at the shop. And I already have a good copy, so I'm good. But then I also like, I just bought like tons of stuff that I'd never heard. That's kind of like the fun side of it, where you're like, oh, that looks awesome. It's got that one musician on it, or that's a record by that guy I know, but I've never seen that one. So I got a ton of stuff that I'm like, I'll probably just want to like listen to as much as I can before I see it. And then I guess the listening will sort of dictate whether I want to keep it longer or not.
Yeah.
But yeah.
That's awesome.
I might have gotten some duds too. We'll see. I know for sure I got this one record called La Vida or like that. I wanted to get Latin records. Like that was my, mm-hmm. one of my goals was to bring back some good Latin records. So
I want to show you, man. I just remembered, this is something I've been looking for years. I finally got it.
Dude, my favorite.
In Leucadia, you know, in North County, San Diego.
Wow.
Yeah.
What shop?
Oh, I feel bad. I think it's like the only one, and I totally forgot the name of it, but maybe I'll put it in the slide right here so we can, okay, tell everybody that there were two. So if you need an Oscar Peterson trio album, that's the one to have, in my opinion. He froze up. Steve froze up. Let's see. Yeah, hey, tell us about the record shop, man. How you doing?
Shop is going. Let's see. We're in its third year. Actually signed a 3-year lease, so the lease is going to be up at the end of this year. But I'm confident I'm going to make it to the end. And like, you know, it's been like a awesome journey. And I think I'm going to like just sort of like I'll talk to the landlord and see about continuing the lease. I'm sure that's going to be cool. Like, we get along pretty good, and I think the shop is good for that little neighborhood.
Congratulations, by the way. That's awesome.
Yeah. So yeah, almost to three. Like, well, just into 200 under the belt, and a little more to go for three. But shop's great. I feel like there's like tons of like great records coming through the shop. I mean, people come every week with a box of records that they want to sell or donate, and so I'm just kind of managing all that and trying to be smart about it, because obviously records take up space. I mean, I would flip the camera around, but it's embarrassing how many records are in my view right here. Embarrassing slash like awesome, because I love it too. But trying to manage the amount, because everyone, people who have records and want to get rid of them, a lot of people are like, I want these to go to a good home. I like enjoyed these my whole life. Like, these are good records, and I don't want to see them just go in the garbage or go to a thrift store. And so I understand that. Like, I get it. And I would probably say the same thing once I start getting rid of more records. But so I kind of take it like pretty seriously. I want to honor that, those collections, and make sure that like I'm giving them a good like second, you know, sort of like opportunity to go to a new home. And it's a little bit of a rescue mission, but yeah, it's, I mean, the shop's super fun. There's like been a, there's a great community that's sort of like grown around it, like the neighborhood people and people who come in from out of town and like shop at the shop. And there's been fun pop-up markets, there's been little concerts in the backyard, there's two vintage shops next door that lean into a lot of those pop-up markets, and so we kind of collaborate on some of that. And we just recently got a PA system to put outside to pump the music, and I got two turntables, so I've been doing more like, and a mixer, so I've been doing more like guest DJs and stuff. So that's kind of evolved a little bit.
Cool, man. Hey, let the people know where you're at, dude. Where's your shop?
It's Mars Records, or online it's Mars Records Shop on Instagram and on the web. And it's on Piedmont Avenue in Oakland, California. So it's like, it's not too far from downtown, from Lake Merritt, if you're familiar with Oakland. It's in this nice little like sort of shopping district, Piedmont Avenue. It's probably like, I don't know, 10 blocks or so. There's some good like restaurants, some bars. There's a good music store up the street, Mountain Music, that in fact, I'll just mention this now, because there's a shop up the street, Mountain Music. And I've gotten to know them pretty good. And the owner, Adam, built me this bass. I said, hot damn, that's the stuff of a pebble tossed, then the water overflows. Yeah, yeah. Like in secrecy. Like he said, he's been working on it since June. I'm not sure how good the lighting is here, but...
It's pretty good. Yeah, yeah. Oh my gosh, what is the deal here?
He like, you know, carved all the wood, and he took the wood from an old piano. So this is like a piano soundboard or something, part of a piano that he like shaped and did kind of like a Tele style, sort of like no fin up here. So that the balance is a little bit different than a regular P bass, and it's got the P and the jazz pickups and like a switch to blend or choose. And it's got this giant like organ. It's like from an organ knob. It's,
yeah.
Like, knob, super huge. And then he called it an ALO bass.
Look at that.
I know. And on the back, the neck plate is like his logo. And then he also put his like personal logo on the back of the neck. So that's his
Adam. Deal. So he makes, it looks like he makes basses, like he makes guitars and stuff.
He makes instruments just for fun. He made one for the girl in the Tea Sisters, one of the girls in the Tea Sisters. And I think he just gets inspired and kind of wants to like I showed up, like, funny, like, coincidence, but I showed up on my birthday. Cause he's like, come by the shop this week. And I was like, okay. He's like, I have something for you. And I just, it happened to be my birthday. And he's like, well, this is, it's a good day. It's good. That's your birthday. I have a gift for you.
No kidding.
I've been working on it since June. And he's like, it's finally done. And I wanted to give it to you. But
that's so awesome. And played it at a gig or recorded any with it yet?
I took it to a gig and I wasn't able to sound check. And I was like, I was a little nervous. Like, I just wanted to like kind of add other things to think about on that gig. So I didn't really want to like bust it out right then and there.
Yeah.
I got a little cold feet a little bit, but I'll take it on tour and I'll definitely play it on Tour Day More.
So, oh, cool.
Yeah, I'm excited.
Are those flats?
They're rounds.
They're rounds. Okay.
Yep. So it's a little brighter. In fact, like almost the first thing I started doing on it was like slapping.
Oh, really?
Which it's really easy to slap and pop on it. And I haven't done that like in forever. Like I used to slap a lot in like high school.
Yeah.
I was like pretty into it. And, yeah. And for some reason, my bass, my P bass, my tried and true old P bass, it's just hard to slap on it.
Yeah.
And this one was like so easy. I was like, oh my God, I can really kind of do that on this bass right now. I'm not sure if it's because the action's lower than my other one. And the round wounds just sound like they want to do that.
Uh-huh.
But I've been, yeah. We'll see how much, if I do that, like, at an ALO show or not.
Yeah, probably. I don't think I've ever seen you slap, like, at an ALO concert. I don't.
I'm not like a, like, some people really get into that style.
Oh, yeah.
And, I'm kind of like, yeah, I don't do it that much.
Yeah.
Okay, current music. But yeah.
Cool, man.
So that's right up. That's on Piedmont.
Uh-huh.
And there's like Fenton's ice cream, and that's a tangent, but there's Fenton's ice cream, there's like coffee shops. Yeah, it's a cool little strip. There's some other vintage shops, and I'm the only record store on that strip right now. So
oh, nice.
Kind of fun actually being like the main hub. There used to be another one. They moved to Rockridge. So now I'm like the only one. But yeah, people gotta come. It's I'm open Wednesday through Sunday, noon to 6.
Yep.
And it's 4125 Piedmont Avenue, right where like 41st Street is, kind of.
Check it out, people. It's a good shop. And there's plenty of restaurants around there. When my wife and I came down, and we've been down a couple of times. Yeah, it's great. It's a great area.
There's like lots of Thai food.
Yeah.
Good burritos.
Man, love it. Yeah, we got a burrito last time we were there. It was the business.
If you come on a Saturday, across the street is Baja Taqueria, and they've been doing like bluegrass jam sessions.
Oh, nice.
Saturdays. So yeah, you can always hit that up too.
Yeah.
And,
cool, man. Let's see. So I want to hear about, what you're doing with those basses, man. You're getting around the Bay Area, you're playing some music outside of your ALO and Big Light.
Yeah. Yeah, Big Light actually had a couple gigs recently, or at least we had one in December. It was super fun. We played at a newer spot called Amato's on Valencia in the Mission. And it's like a downstairs basement. We did a show there. Like we kind of try to do like a holiday show typically in December.
Mm-hmm.
Our guitar player Jeremy is now in New Orleans, so now we have to coordinate that a little bit.
Oh, wow.
But Big Light somehow kind of keeps just sort of rolling along. Fred's always writing music, and Jeremy, well, Jeremy's kind of become like the de facto like engineer producer of the band in a way.
Uh-huh.
We'll do recording remotely and he'll kind of manage all the files and put it together. But we put 3 EPs during the pandemic, more or less, since the pandemic started. So that happened. And we're looking to do another little release and maybe a little East Coast run this summer.
Oh, cool.
And we have plans to play at Jazz Fest second weekend, I think. Yeah.
Like at the festival or like
a bar, like a little bar.
Oh, that's still radical.
So that's Big Light. And then with the shop schedule, I've kind of like, I haven't been able to do as much as many, like, there's sometimes there's day gigs on the weekends I can't do as easy. I was playing with a cover band doing like wedding gigs and stuff for a little while. I was kind of like the sub.
Yeah.
I haven't done too many of those recently, but those are super fun. Like, I watched Rihanna last night at the Super Bowl halftime show.
Yeah.
I personally liked her set. I know there's some debate about that, but I liked it. And that band was doing one of her songs. So I was like, oh yeah, I know this one.
Oh, cool. Yeah.
So that was Mercy and the Heartbeats. That's that band that I kind of sub in for. And then there's, you know, there's always like Grateful Dead stuff kind of happening around the Bay Area. Out in West Marin, there's a bar called the Paper Mill.
Uh-huh.
And there's like a Wednesday night, dead night thing. And this guy, Danny Luring, drummer, sort of organizes it and just gets different people every week. So I've been doing a little bit of that and playing with like Mookie Siegel and Reed Mathis. And
yeah, I saw Reed Mathis's name out there. So he's playing guitar then, huh?
Yeah.
Sweet.
Yeah, totally.
Cool, man. That's gotta be fun playing with, I mean, I don't know if you, I think Reed Mathis and I think of a bass player, but I'm sure he rips on guitar too.
He does. Yeah. I mean, he rips on guitar like the way he rips on bass.
On bass, yeah, I bet.
So he's just on another instrument with two more strings, but.
Yeah, yeah.
But he's one of my favorite musicians to play with. He's like, he's so engaged in music in general. And he's like constantly thinking about it. He's constantly thinking of new ways to do it. He's such a great player. He's like an improviser that on stage in the moment, those moments are really fun because he can kind of take things to different places like very comfortably.
Yeah. Yeah, I've been meaning to check out that last Electric Beethoven album. I think I'll listen to that tonight.
I was stuck and I can only afford the CD. The record's kind of expensive.
Oh, yeah.
I ordered some CDs for the shop and actually sold one this weekend. But that's, yeah, some dead stuff. And then I've also been playing with Tim Bloom, or sorry, Greg Locano
from
the Mother Hips. Yeah, Tim's partner in crime.
Cool.
So Greg's got a band. He's called it Stingray. And I've been kind of playing with Greg in that unit. It's a really good band. And we're playing like all his new songs off his new record, which if you haven't heard, is really good. It's sort of soulful. It's called Giving It All Away.
Uh-huh.
Greg's new record. It's funny I said Tim. There's talk about maybe doing some Breakdown in Bakersfield reunion.
Oh, snap. I just pulled out that album the other day.
This year, so that'd be fun to play with Tim again. I haven't made music with Tim in a long time.
Yeah.
And then Nikki, I'm also doing a gig with in Rhode Island in May.
In May?
Yeah, I think it's a private party, but it's
okay.
Nikki, Alex Coford, Scott Law, and Ross James. And then, it's sort of like a killer super band. Alex, I played a gig with him and Jason Crosby at the Sweetwater in December, and Alex is so fun to play with, as is Jason. That was a cool, it was like a Jason and Friends show.
And that was separate from the Charlie Brown business?
Charlie Brown, Christmas, yeah.
That was awesome, by the way. Yeah, I'm so glad they streamed it. I just saw it the last second. I think Dan posted that they're streaming it, and I said, oh my God, I stopped what I was doing. That was really cool.
I had to I hadn't played up. My upright was literally like behind records in my storage unit.
Uh-huh.
I had to go in there and like just sort of like carve through some boxes to get to it and get it out. I just hadn't played it in like a couple of years, to be honest.
Wow. Yeah.
I pulled it out and I was like, I can't even tell if this is like set up the way it's supposed to be set up. So I took it to a shop and had them look at it, and they did like a little bridge and kind of just made sure everything was like, was good. And actually it did play better after they did that. And then I spent the whole week just sort of like kind of shedding on upright. Like I barely get to my apartment. Like when I have my upright in my apartment, it ends up on my bed.
Oh God.
I basically sleep next to it.
No way. That's like, yeah. You see those posters in like Guitar Player magazine. It's like,
yeah,
you're living it, except it's friggin' twice as big as times as big as an electric guitar. Guitar.
Doing it at some point, and I'm like, oh wait, no.
You guys, you played that material before, but like over the last couple of years, right? That
Yeah,
most of
so
that album.
that was great because we had done that a couple of years ago, and even the year before that, we did it 2 years in a row. So the material was like in there. I didn't have to like sweat learning something brand new. It was kind of like in my brain. Just had to like fish it out.
And did you guys, was that just a one night thing, or did you guys play that at other venues?
Was this one. We debuted it at the Sweetwater probably 4 years ago. And during the pandemic, we did like a stream, like a live stream at Jason's house. Because venues weren't open. That might have been 2020 or 2021, maybe. And then yeah, that might have been 2020. And then maybe we took a year off, or I forget. But yeah, that's most of the side project stuff. I also to do a little like moonlighting at the Independent, where I do the coat check room. It's just like a little, a little extra cash. And
Well,
I kind of like love it because I'll coats. It's like a, it's like a, it's not like the greatest job in the world, but it's actually kind of fun and talking to people and taking coats. And, the coat check room is like right by the stage. So I love it when I get like put on a gig or a night of music where I just don't even know the band. So I've just been seeing all these like bands I probably would have never gone to.
that's awesome.
But yeah, if your listeners ever go out to the Independent in San Francisco, come look for me in the coat check room.
Yeah, that's so funny, man. That's awesome.
Two or three shows a month, so it's pretty minimal. But I had to find things that kind of worked with the record shop. So if I can get to that gig, I can get to like the Paper Mill and Marin. I can get to certain things and still do a night gig somewhere. But my days are a little more like record shop life.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You're living it, man.
Yeah.
So, that's great. Coat checking. Let's see. So, do you want to talk about ALO's new album?
Yeah.
Tell us about it, man. What's it called? When's it coming out? Etc.
Yeah, it's called Silver Saturdays, and it's coming out March 3rd. And there's a pre-order link for vinyl and CD, and I think you can like pre-save it on Spotify or something too, and like other streaming channels. And it drops on the 3rd. We recorded it last year, pretty quickly, like for us, we did it pretty quickly. It's the first like full-length record that we've done with Ezra on drums. And Ezra has like he's got like sort of an expedited sort of approach to working. He likes to keep things moving. And I think me and Zach and Dan, like our like sort of like habits are to be pretty casual. So and Brogan was like he liked to like keep things moving too, but he could also be pretty casual like us. So I think the records of Brogan sometimes like marinated a little longer, maybe than they needed to, or maybe it was just right the way it happened. But with Ezra, I think I feel like it's a little different working with Ezra because I feel like things moved quicker, and maybe even me and Zach and Dan are like, maybe we're maturing to a point where we want to actually be efficient and time, keep track of time. And also studio time is like the clock's ticking, you're spending, however much money you are.
Do you guys
So you want
in?
to.
Yeah, I understand that. And but some albums you like you for the early albums you went out to Jack Johnson's studio, right? You guys went out to Hawaii for one or two albums.
Yeah, we
And so
did.
that was a more chill deal, right? 'Cause you were like
That was a more chill deal, and the studio space, because it was part of the label and it was Jack, it was like a little more relaxed. So what cost us money on that record, that was Man of the World,
Oh, man of the world.
was basically the flights and the lodging. But the studio we got a pretty good rate on. But we were still like we had 2 weeks booked. We can, you know, we did everything. We moved as quickly as we can. It's hard because everyone has their own moments of being kind of precious about the music and like, oh, that wasn't the take for me. Like, I want to fix that. So you just want to be like sort of gentle with everyone, in terms of what people are personally trying to achieve. But so that can push the process, that can make it go longer. But I think with this new record, we, for one, having Ezra kind of being like a little bit of a taskmaster, and then also wanting to do things quickly. And also we were set up in a house where we could all, we let a lot of stuff bleed. So we all four of us played together, like every song started that way.
Sweet.
And we were able to like lay down a lot of great passes as a band, which also kind of made it kind of go quicker, because it let us get into overdubs a little quicker and vocals and things like that. So our basics actually went pretty quickly. Like we were kind of able to do two songs a day, that including like some overdub, getting started on overdubs and stuff. More or less.
Did you guys stay there?
We stayed at an Airbnb. So the new one, the new record, we did in Novato. But and this was at Sun Machine, which is Ryan McCaffrey's house, basically, / studio. And Ryan's in a great band called Go By Ocean. And he's been doing a little more like studio projects and engineering and sort of like co-producing and even renting his space out. So he rented it to us. And we had an Airbnb not too far away. And we'd all like carpool or whatever and get there in the morning and work through the day and the night. And we had 2 5-day sessions. So
okay. That
basically made the record in 2 5-day sessions.
Wow. Which, how long was the break in between?
The break in between was like a month.
Oh, a snap. Okay.
But we kind of did like 5 songs and then 5 songs, just about. Yeah. And actually, maybe it was more like a song a day, now that I think about it.
And did you guys tour? Have you guys toured those songs or played those songs, you know, a lot before you went in?
We were starting to. We kept the record, and then schedules kind of kept pushing. And I think Jenna maybe even at some point was like, you guys should like just like after Tour Day More, like play these songs. This is the last Tour Day More last year.
Uh-huh.
Like just like take Tour Day More to like play a bunch of these and just like feel them out and then go in the studio. We were trying to get in before.
Oh.
Or even the fall before. And she kind of pushed and wanted to push it. And we kind of agreed. And I think it was a great idea to do that, because we were able to play a lot of those songs live. I think there's only 2 songs we didn't play live.
Okay.
Yeah.
And yeah, that I remember hearing Rewind. I wasn't there, but I saw a stream of Rewind at Terrapin Crossroads. And I love that song. The set, you know, the first time I heard it, I was like, oh, that's great. I can't wait to hear that.
I dig that one. That one turned out really good.
Yeah, that's a good one. Do you have any lead vocal songs? Do you have any Steve songs on there?
Yeah. I have 2 songs that I brought in. One we're playing live a little bit called Oil. Uh-huh. And it's kind of a slow jam a little bit. It's kind of a little reggae-ish, maybe.
Right on.
And so I brought that song in, and that one was like that song. Ezra's like, how about I do the basics on percussion and like a cajon? And we started like going in that direction, and we're like, oh, this is perfect. This sounds awesome. So I don't even think there's drums at all in that song. I think it's cajon, my P bass, Lebo on his guitar, and Zach on some keyboards. And that song was almost complete after the basic. Like we didn't add that much more to it.
Well, cool. Looking forward to hearing it.
Yeah. We added some vocal overdubs and maybe a couple other percussions or whatever, but yeah. We got 10 minutes left. Okay.
Yeah. 10 minutes. Yeah.
Cool.
Time check. 10 minutes.
And then the other one is called Rare Air, and that was a new one. And I wasn't sure if like it was good or not, but me and Zach kind of worked on it a bunch in the backyard one day, and got it into like a pretty sweet place where it was like almost like 3 minutes exactly. So like a short little like poppy tune kind of. And that one was inspired by meeting the bass player for the Everly Brothers, this guy Joey Page, who actually ended up helping him put his record out like on digital streaming. And we even did like a short CD run. He signed them all.
That's awesome.
I forget if we talked about that last time or not.
I remember hearing about that. Yeah. And you did that, yeah, work. And I saw you at Selma's, that stuff at the shop.
Yep.
That's
He's
cool.
and he's still down in LA, and that record, like I think it was good for him to get it out. I mean, it was sitting around since 1980. It
Wow.
had Phil Everly on backup vocals. It had Mike Post and Russell Dashiell like producing tracks, and there's like it was cool. So I was happy to help him with that. And in doing that and helping him with that record, I got to know him and like hear some stories and hear about the Everly Brothers tours. And so I ended up like writing this song that was kind of inspired by him, and almost like I almost kind of did it. The song itself is almost like from the perspective of him, but it also sort of a double like perspective for me. And I tried to sort of like walk the line that where it could kind of be both a little bit. But I realized that like him with the Everly Brothers was actually kind of similar to me with Zach and Dan, even though they're not brothers and we're all not brothers. But like I just felt like there's this childhood band that grows up and navigates life together and gets old together or whatever.
Yeah.
I kind of like related to his story, and like his story reminded me of my story a little bit, and also just being a bass player. And
Yeah.
I kind of wanted to tie those worlds together a little bit, and yeah, kind of like just a little tribute to him. And
That's
I,
so cool.
yeah, I'm excited. I haven't played it for him yet.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
Yeah,
Oh, that's rad.
I've been holding out, so I'm not sure. Like, I want to make a video for it, actually. I'm gonna see if I can figure out a budgety way, little video for it. I got
Yeah.
some ideas, but yeah, I'm sure.
Well,
I guess I'll share that with him on. I guess he'll just hear it when it comes out. Maybe I'll send him a CD or a record or something.
yeah, make sure you tell him the
Yeah.
deal. Yeah, and that's I wanted to talk about the fact that you guys have been doing this for, you're coming up on your 25th anniversary, right?
Yeah, as a band, as ALO, yeah.
That's yeah. And
Yeah.
go ahead.
We had different band names before that. So like you could even as a like me, Zach, and Dan, we go back to 1989, which I think is like 30 some years. But yeah, ALO started in 98, our senior year in college, basically. And so that's what 25 years goes back to. And
Yeah.
that's the silver anniversary. And
Right.
we didn't know that we didn't think about that when we picked the album title, because we're already doing this like Silver Saturdays theme at concerts and stuff. And then when we landed on that, we're like, oh wait, that's perfect. That's like it's also our 25th anniversary, so it's a good title for that.
Yeah. And so yeah, you guys have a tour coming up in March, and you guys are starting in Crystal Bay, Nevada, right? Tahoe area. And 25th anniversary tour. I hope you guys have some cool merch that reflects that 25th anniversary business. We'll see, I hope.
Great idea that no one's actually brought up.
Yeah.
We're like, let's get like a, it's we want like a good merch run of Silver Saturday stuff, the album that kind of like ties to the album. So I think we have some socks we're working on with like the
Oh,
album
nice. I'll wear the hell out of those.
coming. But and then we're like, we should also just regular merch, like just whatever. And then but no one's talked about 25th anniversary merch. That's a good. It's gonna come and go quick, so
Yeah.
yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, don't make people wait till the 30th.
I
No,
know.
we'll all wait for the 30th. It's fine.
26 just doesn't have the same ring, so
Yeah. What is ALO to you? Like, if a kid in California comes to see you guys for the first time, what are they coming to see? What's ALO about?
I would say ALO is like, it's like family oriented. It's like the band like we grew up together, so there's this like, sort of family life bond between us, and I think that comes across on stage and in our writing even. There's lots of songs that reflect back to us as kids, being in the band in the garage and writing tunes. So there's lots of like. And I feel like hopefully that kind of comes across and people feel very welcome at an ALO show and are kind of like included in the in this like community that's sort of like blossomed out of the band. And with that, I hope people really enjoy the music, because that's what we're aiming to do, is create good music, write good music, play it well, you know, have some exciting improvisation that feels like you're really in the moment. And hopefully, you know, sing along if you know the song, and definitely dance if you're feeling it. And I feel like it's a good party. I feel like it's a great party. And we typically have like some fun little things we'll do at a show with like stage decor or like audience participation stuff, and play some fun covers. And yeah, so I would hope that it's a good fun time.
Well, let me tell you, it is being on the other side of the stage.
Nice.
Yeah, man. And the covers, dude. Like, I remember seeing you guys in the early days. I think you guys are the reason I got into Steely Dan, man, because you guys were playing the deep cuts from the Royal Scam. You guys were playing Green Earrings and the Fez and all that stuff.
We wanted to cover the Royal Scam at one point. I mean, maybe we still will, but Steely Dan is a huge influence on us. Like, just the writing, the humor in it, you know, it's there's a lot of jazz in there, and we're all kind of like into, yeah, like more than rock. Like, we kind of go a little deeper in music if we can. And Steely Dan did that masterfully.
Yeah.
My message to you is be true to what grows on.
But to be honest, the Fillmore is, I like all those venues, but the Fillmore is my favorite.
Oh, good. That's what I was going to ask. You know, on this next tour, like, what are you most excited about?
I'm really excited for that. And it's the third week into the tour, so we'll hopefully be nice and warmed up and kind of grooving good. And I'm excited for the whole tour. I love all the places we're playing. I think Venice West is going to be fun.
I'll see you guys there.
Our last gig there was cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's going to be a good tour. It's so Tour de Amor is happening in March this year, so a little different, but we'll have some lucky charms with us.
Sweet deal. And yeah, I might lose you any second now, but who's coming with you? Who's coming with you on the road?
There's Ron Artise, who's, you might know him from Hawaii, maybe. Yep. Ron Artise II, he's opening for us at the Fillmore. And besides that, we have the Rainbow Girls back on tour with us. Did a tour with them some years ago, and they've just gotten better and better and better. They're so good.
Sweet.
They're doing a bunch of dates. And then our Tahoe dates are with Orgone and Hot Butter Drum. So those will be big blowout special gigs with two really, you know, well-established bands.
Good deal.
All day. Like, so if you can imagine. I was just kind of jamming over that bass line.